really well, Oliver. Yeah, thank you. I'm really well.
Good, good man. Thank you very much for coming on. I really appreciate it. Thank you for taking
You're welcome. I obviously listened to your podcast with Omar, and when you invited me on, I thought, yeah, why not? I haven't done something like this for a while, so it's quite nice.
All right. Okay, good. I'm glad you enjoyed the podcast with Omar. It was a bit of a revelation, really, a real eye-opener for me. So, yeah, I'm really looking forward to this one. But yeah, I mean, as with Omar, best place to start, I think, is, you know, at the beginning. Just to try to get right down to the very beginnings of what happened and where and how you got to where you are today. So if you just want to spend a few moments just explaining that.
Yeah, sure. Well, it goes back a number of years, almost to black and white days. I feel like we should have some lines on the screen. But no, I mean, for me, my life in the criminal justice system began when I was 10 years old. But prior to that, I'm the youngest of six children, everything that came with that. It wasn't a terrible home childhood or childhood home. I was the youngest of six, so you can imagine I was picked on quite a lot, bullied quite a lot, got a lot of hand-me-downs. But I only have happy memories of that, if that makes sense. When I was eight, 9 years old, I experienced sexual abuse, not from a stranger, which is something that the government years ago got wrong by warning everyone of stranger danger. It's people closer at home that you really need to be careful of. And although it wasn't a family member and it wasn't a relative, it wasn't a stranger. It was a toy shop owner. So he had access to plenty of grooming materials in respect to toys and that. But after that, it wasn't long after that, I contracted meningitis. And soon after that, my first arrest for criminal damage. And I suppose really from there on, it was downhill. Went to a really bad secondary school. I got expelled from that at the age of 14, got put in a pupil referral unit, as they're now known, got expelled for that after 2 weeks. And because I was already involved with the criminal justice system with probation, under supervision from probation while I was at school, I began my schooling I started to be schooled at probation, me and another lad, coincidentally from the same school. We'd do a bit of maths, English, geography in the morning, but in the afternoon we'd be taken to do 10-pin bowling, play golf, obviously depending on the weather, play snooker, whatever, but we'd do some kind of games activity in the afternoon. So I loved it, to be honest. I really enjoyed it there. It didn't stop me getting in trouble though, nor did probation. And by the age of 15, I experienced my first period of custody, 4 months detention centre, HMDC, Blantyre House in Kent. And then I went on a kind of couple of years rampage, if you like, back in detention centre, back in youth custody. And then around the age of 19, 20, I thought it was time to calm down. Got married to someone that had a child from another man. The idea was to bring up as my own. And then it felt the right thing to do for everyone else. It wasn't the right thing for me to do. And for no fault of my ex-wife, no fault of hers, it all went wrong. And it wasn't right to begin with. I wasn't relationship material even back then, or should I say back then. And I was drinking drugs, not heavy drugs, just like cannabis, well, hashish as it was then. As I say, it wasn't really her fault. But then at the age, well, I just turned 21, my own flat, mortgage, married, bringing up a kid. And my mum died and she was only 59. It was 2 days before her 50th birthday. And though I weren't right before, that really did shake me to the what's that term? Shake me to the foundation. Shake me to the foundations. That's it.
Yeah.
And I didn't live a life. I was bouncing from relationship. Well, I split up with my ex-wife, went into another relationship, moved to London. Things were all right, but I wasn't, and I was still committing crime. I was trying to do legal work, but I couldn't hold a job down. It just wasn't right for me. I just wasn't in that right frame of mind. I wasn't a career criminal, I suppose. I was pretty good at that. Just because I've been in prison doesn't mean to say I got caught for everything. That's not with an ego, but I committed a lot of crime, and I didn't get put away for all of it. So I wasn't bad. And then crime and mental health come together. And from 97, I really started to sort of drift a lot downhill, really drinking heavy, got done for drink driving in 97, lost my license. Really struggled to hold my relationship together with who I was with at the time. And she's the mother of two sons. My first wife, although I was bringing up another child, after my mum died, she gave birth to my first born daughter. Then my second relationship, I had my two sons. But I was never a dad, if that makes sense. I might have fathered three children, but I was never a dad. I was never responsible. I never acted responsibly. I mean, I've got a lot to be responsible for and to be accountable for. And it wasn't really until kind of later life that I started to realize how much of an effect my childhood had had on me as an adult. But then when you're an adult, it's a bit too late. Do you know what I mean? If I'd have known what I knew now back then, I might have been able to do something about it. But then I wouldn't, because I was a child. So it was, if you like, the adults around me really that needed to kind of pick me up rather than keep punishing me. Then I had some serious offences at the beginning of the century, serious GBH against a friend of a family. But he, again, I mean, I tried claiming self-defense on that, but I did go over the top, and I could have handled it slightly different. But I'd, unfortunately, with the police turning up, I kicked off with them as well. So I had a serious assault charge, Section 18, plus a few assaults against the police. Managed to do a bit of plea bargaining, and I got community service. I ended up with 300 hours community service. And that was a result, rather than a wake-up call, it was a result. Not long after that, I got sectioned. I went off the rails a bit in Canvey Island, got picked up off the street by an ambulance, got taken to Southend Hospital, seen by a psychiatrist who sectioned me for kind of my own safety, really. I mean, I was suicidal at the time as well. That was in Runwell Hospital in Essex. That was a horrible place, absolutely horrible place. But that didn't really, that was just a temporary kind of destination, if you like. Come out of there, things still weren't going right. And then 2004, I was on a combination order from the courts, which is like a mixture of different things. So it was a community service, plus I had to do an aggression replacement therapy program and a 56-day tag, which I only made 55 days off before. It was local to me. A friend's wife had claimed that this person had raped her a couple of years ago, and he had got away with it. And it was kept at arm's length. And then one night I see him. He was with his uncle, and he gave me a dirty look. So says, "From what are you looking at, you rapist?" And it kicked off. And again, it was self defense, but there was two of them. They got hurt. So I ended up getting in quite a bit of trouble for that. And that started me back in prisons again. 2004, got out 2006, back in 2008, out 2010, back in again almost immediately. back out, back in again, almost immediately recall, back out. And then I moved away, moved to Wales. You can't run away from you. Within weeks, I was in HMP Cardiff, got judging chambers from there, which means that when you're on remand, that means you get refused bail at court. And you have an opportunity, whilst you're on remand in prison, to have your case heard by a judge in chambers, hence judging chambers. It's slightly different. And basically, it's your defence putting forward a case for your release on bail while the waiting for the case to be heard. And if he accepts their argument, there has to be new evidence. If he accepts your argument, you get bail. If he doesn't, you don't. It's as simple as that. You stay in. I was fortunate I got it. I went to live with my daughter, my eldest daughter, and things went wrong there. Moved in with another family member, things went wrong there. Got back with an ex-partner, moved to another part of the country, moved to Norwich. Everything went wrong there. Ended up back on the streets. I was in a bad way, drugs, alcohol, I was taking anything that moved, really. If you could sniff it, I would. Probably talcum powder at some point, I don't know. But I was in a bad way. And I tried getting myself sorted out with the council, but because of my past, because of my history, I was high risk. They couldn't temporary house me, so I had to stay on the streets while everything, the investigation was going through and all of this. And then one night, I just had enough, and I had kind of contemplated suicide. I've attempted my own life a few times over the years. 2009 in prison, a real serious attempt. I'm fortunate to still be here after that attempt. And then 2015, as I say, I was homeless in a bad way. And I just thought to myself, well, I don't want to die. I want to live. I just don't want to live like this anymore. And I really was in a hole. And then I found myself in a situation. I had a... what I thought was a rational thought, but clearly irrational, and that was, there's only one place for me to go, and that's prison. That's the only place that I knew where I could go and sort myself out from a really, believe it or not, strong foundation. The situation I was in was dire. So prison, for me, would have been a really strong platform for me to try and rebuild my life, if you like, or change my life, not rebuild it, change it. Because regardless... it was the decisions and the mistakes that I've made over the years while I was in that situation. Yes, I'm neurodivergent. Yes, I had trauma as a child. Yes, I was excluded from school. However, I still made choices and I was still responsible for those choices. So I was in I had all that, if you like, but I wasn't in the right environment to be able to put all that together. And that's when I chose to commit a crime that I would then get caught on purpose for. The crime had to be serious enough to give me long enough in prison for me to do what it was that I wanted to do, which is what I do today. No doubt we'll chat about that. And I wanted 5 years. I ended up with 3 years, 9 months, which was just enough time for me to make another mistake in prison and... be given another chance and turn my life around, and the rest is history, as they say. And there's that.
Wow. What a story. Thank you very much for sharing it with me. I really appreciate
you're that. Welcome. You say that, and I think if people listen to Omar's podcast, we're completely two different people, but there's so many similarities between myself and Omar. And it's just not between myself and Omar, but there's so many similarities between people like Omar, people like myself, yeah, in prison. And we'll get to it. But understanding that was a major reason why I was able to turn my own life around.
No, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, when I was speaking to Omar, he explained that he got into difficulties at the age of 5. He was playing on the railway line, so he got electrocuted. And from there, his childhood just spiraled out of control. And
how can that not be trauma? I mean, that alone, you can kind of put your finger on, can't you? I mean, I'm not going to start discussing his life and the reasons why, if you like, but when you look at it as a bigger picture, I mean, unless that was going to be dealt with, that was going to have an impact in later life.
I mean, did you find this a similar situation with yourself looking back? Did you sort of
Looking back, yeah, I mean, it's
meningitis?
hindsight's wonderful. I mean, it's easy, and of course, not just hindsight and age and experience, but being able to kind of speak to other people and what other people, their backgrounds are. But then getting into research and reading other things and stuff like that, and obviously ACEs, adverse childhood experiences, and things like that. And it sounds like I was searching for excuses when I wasn't. I was actually looking for reasons, because we're not born bad. There's a reason. There's something happens, and then that has a ripple effect. And the, if you like, the support, the intervention, the prevention, if you like, that will limit the number of ripples that you have. So if you don't have that support, if you don't have that intervention, those ripples will carry on, well, infinitely.
Absolutely. You mentioned at the beginning of the call that you're one of six children. Is that right? Are you the youngest?
I am, yeah.
Okay. They often say the youngest get lots of attention. Was that the case with you? What did you?
I got enough attention. I got lots of attention. Not the right attention, but I got lots of it. It's, I think that, I mean, obviously between the first child and the sixth child, my oldest sister, and myself, there was a number of years. So,
Right.
they were kind of getting, they were starting to move on, if you like, in as adults. I think there's that. I'm trying to think the difference in our ages. I think it's about 12 years, I think, between the two of us. All right, she would have been 12, but by the time I'd have been old enough, she would have kind of moved on. So I don't remember many of my siblings at home. I don't really remember my oldest sister. Just about remember my oldest brother. Sorry, I've got three sisters and two brothers. So, and we actually went girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, boy. So my oldest sister, my older brother, I just about remember him at home. So obviously the other ones, I remember them as well. I was closest to my youngest sister. So the next oldest one after me, me and her were quite close. And I mean, I've got a lot for her to be grateful to her for, because she got me in, she used to teach, well, taught me to read at a very young age. And growing up, rather than buy sweets, I used to buy comics because I used to love to read. Freedom's a state of mind. And even as a youngster, reading the comics and things like that, I mean, this was before anything had happened to me, or that I know of anything that happened to me. That's the first thing that I know that happened to me. But yeah, so I mean, reading comics. So I mean, I wasn't, and I could sit there and read a book. So I don't suppose I was garnering attention in that way, if you like. But then that was before things had happened. But then I didn't know what's happening to me. I mean, I was obviously releasing my feelings, but I didn't understand what those feelings were that I was releasing in the way that I was releasing them, because I was a kid. I mean, how do I know? Do you know what I mean? And I don't. I don't blame my parents. I don't blame my family. I don't really blame anyone, because things were different back then. You weren't neurodivergent. You were challenging and disruptive. And I was challenging and disruptive. But that started at an early age with school, and obviously went on. But I wasn't a naughty child because I was a bad child. I was a naughty child because of the things that had happened to me.
So just in the lead up to when you said you were excluded from school, do you remember like how you were feeling and
I hated school. I hated school. I'd done everything I possibly could not to go. I'd spend a lot of time truanting from school with friends that would also truant, or skive off, as it's called. My first year at senior school, I suppose I was getting my feet under the table. It was quite an experience, your first year of senior school. And the school that I went to was a rough, rough school. It was in the middle of a council estate. There's actually a book called Schooling the Council Kids, Council Estate Kids, that was written by a professor that's about the council estate and the school where I grew up. He doesn't give it. Well, he actually describes what I remember. When they used to get the supply teachers, when they used to get told they were going to Cunningham, which was what the school was called, they'd cry. They'd break down and cry. It was a rough, rough school. But in the second year, that was where, I mean, I was getting in trouble with the police by that point anyway. Before senior school, I was in trouble with the police. So as I say, the first year was, I was a bit concerned, but one of the best things, I don't know, in respect of identity, being the youngest of six, going to the same infant school, going to the same junior school, you're not like your brother, you're not like your sister, you're not, being the youngest of six at home, you're being called all your siblings' names before you get called your name. So I remember at a young age, I belonged to a Concord youth club and playing football for them. And I changed my first name. So when it was in the paper, it was Tony Breakspear. And I was like, well, who's Tony Breakspear? It's like, they knew. I don't know why I did it. I mean, obviously, again, I was only young. I don't know why I did it, but it was obviously it was this identity thing. Yeah. And when I started playing up at school, two of my cousins had gone there, or three of my cousins had gone there, two male and a female. The female cousin was great. She was brilliant there. But my two cousins weren't. They were proper bastards at the school. And once I started playing up, you're just like your brothers. Yeah, sorry, you're just like your cousins. You're no different than your cousins. So I had an identity that I could match. And they were fighters at school. They fought at school. They obviously committed crime away from school. But they become my role models. Again, I'm not blaming them. They had their own issues going on in life. I mean, I don't know their story as such. All I saw was how they were reacting to whatever it is that was going on in their life. But I didn't see that. Obviously, I just saw them. And they were well-liked as well. I mean, I started off as a school class, not sorry, school. I started off as a class clown. And it wasn't long before I become a bully. I'm not going to deny that. We had a group. We weren't a gang. We were a group. And we were horrible. Well, we were horrible kids. We really were horrible kids. Yeah. And outside of school, and the thing is as well, when you're excluded from school, all the other kids are in school. The only other kids that are out of school are the kids that have been kicked out of school. So more than likely, your mates. So you gang up in school, you gang up out of school. And we would go out shoplifting during the day. Then obviously you get involved with the adults and hanging around with adults when you're excluded from school. You're not hanging around with adults that are, if you like, role models that are working, that have 9-to-5 jobs, a car, this, that, and the other. You're hanging about with adults that aren't working and more likely committing crime because of the environment, the kind of area that it was. So at a young age, I say a young age, probably like 12, 13, I was working, doing bits and pieces for adults as much as what I was doing with schoolmates and mates. So, I mean, we were active. We were extremely active, doing a kind of inquisitive crimes, if you like. The local police hated us, we had which kind of expanded throughout my life that I wouldn't have no respect for the police at all over my life, if you like. I do now. It's completely changed. But yeah, I mean, your childhood has so much effect on you. But in respect of your question and attention, I don't recall that fight for attention at home. I did a lot with my mum and dad. I recall a lot of going shopping and helping my mum with Big Shop, as we used to call it, Big Shop. I used to go to the greengrocers and get the kind of 25 kilo bags of potatoes. So I remember doing lots of chores for my mum. My mum taught me to cook. I learned a lot of my mum cooking. So, but then my mum and dad also had their own life as well. They played bingo a lot in the evenings. My dad was a secretary of a local pool league, so he was always out and about around the pubs. As I got older, I kind of went with him a bit. So yeah, I mean, it was it weren't attention I was after. That wasn't what I was after. Looking back, it's very difficult for me to say what it was that I was after. But I know that attention wasn't one of it. Wasn't one of them.
Yeah, and understood. It just seems to me like from talking to you, and obviously I'm a complete outsider and I don't know much about this kind of life or this world, but it seems to me as if the school structure had some kind of knock-on effect for the rest of your life, because I'm guessing that when you're excluded from school, it felt a little bit like maybe being excluded from society. Would you say that's
true? You are. Yeah, no, 100%. You are. Once you're excluded from school, you're excluded. You might as well be excluded from society, because you really are swimming against the tide of life. Then you're beginning your kind of early teenage years, whatever age it is that you get kicked out of school. That's you beginning with a massive minus. Yeah, and you can't catch up. It's very difficult for you to be able to catch up. I mean, if you're put into a pupil referral unit, to move on to college and further education, you need 5 GCSEs. Only 1% of pupils in a pupil referral unit hit that grade. So 99% are kind of, well, are in prison, most of them. Don't get me wrong, not everyone. And that's the thing. School exclusions are not the reason for prison. That's just a part of it. It's the behaviour before that leads to the school exclusion. But what's behind that behavior? That's what we need to get to. What's behind that behavior?
What do you think?
It's anything. It could be a breakup at home. I mean, obviously, Omar's story, 5 years old, electrocuted. Again, I'm slightly older than Omar, but they wouldn't have had a lot of kind of trauma-informed practices back then. They weren't aware of as much as what they're aware of these days, which makes me more frustrated, the fact that we're not doing the things that we should be doing. All right, they've got half an excuse why they weren't doing it in my day or Omar's day, but they have no excuses why it's not happening now. And yet thousands upon thousands of children are still being excluded from school each year. If you look at suspensions, I think suspensions are around about 350,000 a year. Periods of suspension, and I think it's just something like 3,500 pupils are permanently excluded. Now, when I was last released, or last in prison, which is when I was last released, 2017, according to the Institute of Public Policy, there was 85,975 people in prison at that time. 54,164 of them, or us, had been excluded from school. So although you're not guaranteed to end up in prison if you're excluded from school, there's a very good chance you are going to be ending up in prison. And that, for me, is what the school system is in some aspects is all about. It separates the wheat from the chaff. The wheat go on to your kind of universities, and your chaff fill up the prisons. And it's so wrong. It's not right. I'm not saying that people shouldn't be responsible for their own choices they make in life. However, we've got to understand the platforms these people are making decisions and their choices from. They're not making a decision and a choice from having a normal home life with two parents. Dad's got a job, mum's got a job. They go on holiday three times a year. They've got three pets and chickens in the garden. they're making choices from having to still to eat. Do you know what I mean? It's they've got one parent. If they've got any parents, they're being abused physically, mentally, sexually, whatever. But these are the areas that we need to be looking at, not looking at our prisoners going, oh, look at them, they're all bad people. No, they're not. They're all once innocent and forgotten children.
Yeah, I think that, you know, we tend to forget that. But when we see people jailed for sentences, we think, well, you know, serves them right. And but I think that we never really think about the backstory that led to that person.
We never do. No, we never do. And to be honest with you, Oliver, if we were, I would say in probably 80, 90% of the cases, rather than be angry, be upset. Yeah. And be asking questions of the government, be asking questions of the local authorities. You'll be saying, where was you when he needed you?
Mm-hmm.
It's like crying after the milk's been spilt. You know what I mean? It's like, it's so easy to point a finger at someone that's committed a murder and call them bad, but then take a step back and look at their life beforehand and where it started. Mm-hmm. And then see how many opportunities were missed by local authorities, by the government, to have intervened and then not end up in prison for murder.
You're right. It's just dealing with the symptoms and not addressing the root causes. And
exactly, exactly. And you get all this rhetoric of being tough on crime. It's such the wrong path to take. We need to be smart on crime. We need to be sensible with our sentencing. We need to sentence the individual rather than sentence the crime itself. Because one, people aren't born bad. They become bad because of something normally that's happened to them. But everyone can change. Virtually everyone can change. The sooner that you intervene, the quicker that change and the more significant that change will be. But obviously, the later you leave it, I mean, it took me 9 prison sentences before I was able to turn my life around. Did I ask for enough help? Probably not. But then I was labelled as being this, that and the other. So I didn't think I needed help. I was always battling with your... It's like, no, you're the ones with the problem. I had a bad attitude. It's as simple as that. But then the system had a bad attitude as well. We punish too soon without having a little bit of compassion, a little bit of empathy and trying to understand the person's position beforehand. That's not to say there aren't bad people in prison, because there are some people out there committing some very nasty, disgraceful, disgusting, disturbing crimes, and therefore deserve to be punished. However, are they criminals or are they sick people? There's a big difference between being a criminal and being sick.
It's interesting that you bring up the term sickness, because I suppose if you saw the whole issue through the lens of being a health issue, do you think that it might be easier to find a solution?
Well, look, I mean, I've never been in a high security state. I've never received an indeterminate sentence. An indeterminate sentence is a prison sentence basically for life. You can still come out, but if you do come out, you'll be on life license. So you can be recalled to prison anytime throughout your life. I've never received one of those. So I don't understand that part of it. For me, it's about people who are trapped in the revolving doors of crisis and crime. People that are constantly in and out of prison. I mean, people like myself. That's the kind of the majority of prison where early... Well, I mean, the whole of prison is where early intervention is needed. But in respect of looking at it from a health point of view, for people that are trapped and involved in doors of crisis and crime, to continuously punish them for their situation they're in is pointless. It doesn't work. We need to find an alternative way. I mean, if someone's done 20 prison sentences and the worst thing they've done is still 3 bottles of whiskey from Tesco's, do they really need protecting from the public? Or are we just solely punishing them from retribution? It's, do you know what I mean? And when you look at the people who are trapped in revolving doors, you can see the areas that it's the multiple disadvantages, the poverty, trauma, drug addiction, alcohol addiction, gambling addiction. There are, but those are brought on by trauma. in their childhood, which has been brought on by whatever that has created that trauma. In Omar's respect, he was electrocuted on the train tracks. In my respect, I was sexually abused by someone I knew. In other children's respect, they were sexually abused by their parent, or they're physically abused by their parents, or they're physically abused, sexually abused by a neighbor. Do you know what I mean? There's so many different things that have gone on in someone's childhood that unless it's dealt with, it's going to impact them later on in life and they're going to be in prison.
David, that's all very interesting. I found you on LinkedIn, as you know, and I've been reading some of your posts, and I've got to say, it's really eye-opening to see the views that you have, because you know they seem to make a lot of sense, and I can see that they are resonating with people. You know, according to your experience, do you see any other jurisdictions in the world which are doing things better, or something that the UK could learn from?
Yeah, Portugal. Portugal in 1998 began a decriminalisation programme, and they started to look at drug addiction from a position of health rather than from a position of criminality. And what they did is anyone caught with 10 days or less worth of personal drugs, that was decriminalised. So they didn't stop the drug dealing, they didn't stop arresting drug dealers. They didn't stop arresting drug traffickers. What they did stop doing was they stopped arresting users, and they found a different way. And they started doing health and wellbeing programs. Basically, rather than send someone to prison, they go on to a short duration program to address their issues, rather than be sitting in prison being punished for their multiple disadvantage.
Sounds like it's working, you know.
It is working, and they're not only. I think it was something like in the 90s before the program began, they had 100,000 heroin addicts. Now they have 25,000.
Right.
There was in respect of people that were turning up to the program with HIV. From obviously when it began to where they are now, there's been a 90% drop. They're seeing lower than European averages for drug use, especially amongst young people between 15 and 24. So it's not just crime that's dropping, it's health that's getting better and being improved. The police are having less time to deal with those issues and more time to focus on the bigger crimes, on the trafficking, on the suppliers. I mean, everyone benefits. The whole of community benefit just by taking a little bit of backward step and having a rethink about what it is that we're doing.
And why do you think that in the UK prison system that hasn't happened yet? Do you think it's to do with lack of awareness, or is there something
political will? It's political will in this country. The criminal justice system, unless they're being tough on the criminal justice system, doesn't win votes. And look, and I can understand that. I mean, I only care because I was involved in the criminal justice system. If I wasn't involved in the criminal justice system, who knows what I would be thinking about the criminal justice system? I'll probably believe the headlines of the Daily Mail. I'd be a mug that I do know now, but I'd probably believe the Daily Mail headlines because it's constant. It's like when I was young, being told that I was challenging the disruptive, you're going to end up in prison, blah, blah, blah. They were right. They were deterministic. So it's the same effect. If you just tell it, but it's fear, isn't it? We have to, there's 650 politicians. There's 60 million people in this world. Do you know what I mean? Yet they got the power. How does 60 million people in Britain. So how have they got the power? How have 0.1% of the population got the power? And that's through fear. They govern through fear. And if you can keep people in enough fear, and that's what the criminal justice system does. So yeah, reframing the criminal justice system from a basis of health, the public won't accept it. And therefore, the government won't be voted and they won't get the next election.
What do you think about the financial argument? Because I think it's something like £45,000 worth per prisoner is spent on keeping people in prison. Do you think that there's a financial argument that people can get behind and politicians can get behind? You know, to save money, we should focus on rehabilitation, reduce recidivism.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'm not an economist. However, it clearly makes sense that if it costs more to send someone to prison than it does to support them in the community, you're wasting money. Prison is part of the problem. It isn't a solution in respect of reducing reoffending. The horse has already bolted. What we need to do is we need to be spending, rather than spend £245 million on a brand new prison, we need to invest that money into the education system and stop school exclusions. We need to find a better way of dealing with our children and stop failing them, because that's the reason why our criminal justice system has such a large population, because the people in there were failed as children. And like I say, not everyone, but the majority were failed as children. And now they're in the criminal justice system. Everyone's, oh, look at them in criminal justice. So, well, where were you when they were kids? Why weren't you making a noise when they were children and this was happening? Why wait until they're in the criminal justice system before you start complaining about who they are?
Completely agree, and that's actually just one of many reasons why I'm so glad you came on today, you know, to talk to me about this, because I'm hoping that anyone watching can understand a little bit better now about the factors that lead to people committing crime. And I think there may be a bit of an education gap that people need to jump.
Look, you can't. I don't want to say this the wrong way. I can't claim someone for being ignorant if they don't know. But if you know, I mean, if you're reading the Daily Mail every day, you're only going to have this narrative view, sorry, narrow view of the criminal justice system, that everyone's a murderer, rapist, paedophile, terrorist, when our prison system is so very much more than that. The small minority are your high risk. It's the bigger majority where the revolving doors of crisis and crime exist. Where, but then having said that, people aren't born terrorists. They're not born rapists. They're not born paedophiles. People, even serial killers were innocent children once. Whenever you watch programs on the TV about serial killers, you always find a point in their childhood where something that happened. And then you can kind of see why, if you like. It doesn't excuse it, but you can see why they've gone on to commit the crimes they've done. But not only can you see why they've gone on to commit the crimes that they've done, you can also see the amount of missed opportunities the authorities have had in being able to intervene and stop that from happening. But no one else gets the blame apart from the individual who commits the crime. I think there's an African, well, I don't think I know. There's an African saying, it takes a village to raise a child. But it goes on to say a child can also burn down a village just to feel its warmth.
Yeah, I've heard that too, and that's so true. That really is.
Yeah, it's we really need to start, instead of talking about being trauma informed, actually be it. Be trauma responsive, but stop being trauma responsive when it's too late. The sooner the better. Early intervention. Let's start. And I don't expect, in the same way, I don't expect prison officers, prison officers to be experts in everything. I expect them to have an understanding of things that are going to be relevant. And that's the same for teachers. I don't expect them to be an expert in every single field. But then I do expect them to have an understanding of trauma. Understanding that the child in front of them is acting out because they haven't got a bed to sleep in, because they have to wash their own clothes, because they're a sole carer for their younger brother, because their mum's an alcoholic, their mum's a drug addict. There's so many reasons behind it, but that's when that child's 10. Unfortunately, when they're 25 committing crime, you don't see that. You just see the crime that they're committing at 25. So, for me, that's one thing that the public need to understand is stop reading the headlines, read behind, sorry, stop believing the headlines, believing the story, read behind it, read between the lines. Because as I say, not everyone is born, or not anyone, are born bad. They turn bad for whatever reason.
Yeah, and I fully agree actually with you, and thank you for explaining it. And you mentioned earlier that, you know, before it's too late. I'm glad to say that it's not been too late for you. I've seen
No, it's not too late. It's not too late, but the point is, it's a lot bloody harder.
Yeah.
It takes a lot more work when you're 40 than what it would have done when I was 14.
Well, let's speak about that, about the work that you've done.
Yep.
You've set up some organizations since you've
there are other people's organizations. The first one, Starting Step, they're a company, a social enterprise in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
And the CEO, Dodie Peter, she approached me on social media. It wasn't about anything at first. It was just obviously a chat. And she was looking for a non-executive director, with a person with lived experience, to become a non-executive director to help them develop and kind of guide the business going forward. And after speaking to Dodie for 5 minutes, I invested straight away my time, not money. And the same really with New Beginnings North. Joanne Vance, the CEO of that, absolutely. Just her and Dodie are just incredible women, absolutely incredible women. They really are they're tornadoes, honestly. They just this is what I'm going to do, and the next thing they do it, and it's done. Do you know what I mean? They're just incredible women. New Beginnings North is another organisation, another social enterprise, if you like, that was set up to help people in the criminal justice system. They both help people in the criminal justice system. And Joanne spoke to me about becoming a non-executive director and bringing my lived experience on board to the board. And again, listening to Joanne for 5-10 minutes, and Joanne's got a lovely Irish accent, but listening to Joanne 5-10 minutes, I couldn't say yes quick enough to that either.
And how did it make you feel when they approached you for these roles? Did it give you a sense of happiness or feeling needed? And was that important for you?
Having your lived experience valued, because you've got to understand my lived experience, I wasn't exactly ex-SAS, do you know what I mean? So my lived experience isn't something you typically want to shout from the rooftops. Have that value, and that's what I wanted to do as well. I wanted to kind of use the negative aspects of all of that lived experience to help others moving forward. And if that is the person, the individual, or an organization or a charity, then so be it. To kind of have that lived experience valued at such a high level is incredible. But to have it continually validated in the board meetings we have, the work that's been going on in the organisations. I don't want to say too much because I want people to actually listen to this and then go and research New Beginnings North and Starting Step, because they're two incredible, obviously I'm biased, but they're two incredible organisations that are doing fantastic works either side of the border. Go and check them out, people. With the work, as I say, that I continue to do with them, I feel like Tony Blair doing it. The work that I continue to do with them, I can't explain it. I can't explain how it makes me feel. At first, I know it's a kind of cliche now, but imposter syndrome. But both Dodie and Joanne, in their own separate ways with me, made me feel extremely comfortable, and I feel an integral part of the team.
It's absolutely fascinating to listen to you, and it's so inspiring to hear how you've managed to turn things around and work towards the common good, helping other people to avoid the same pitfalls that you.
But look, I'm not going to lie. And we'll get on to the work I do with Revolving Doors as well. But in a selfish way, it helps me just as much. The more that I do, the more that I can turn those negatives into a positive. Not only that, with the work I do at Revolving Doors, I'm now a peer mentor there. So I'm kind of a role model, if you like. That's not having an ego, but that's what a peer mentor is, a role model. So I'm in a position in my life now where, because of what I've done so far since I've been out, I'd be so ashamed to go back to prison. I would, I'd probably attempt my own life because of the shame that I would feel in prison, because of where I am now. I would let so many people down. And that, as well as having a purpose in life, which is what I have, because I want to, well, I want the criminal justice system to change and the education system. And that's going to be quite a number of years' work. So I've got the rest of my life sorted.
Just tell me, like, what's your family life like now? Now that you're out and you've found a purpose drive, to fix the world for the better. What's your family life like now? Is it stable? Well, more stable than it was, or is it?
Oh yeah, 100%, 100%. I 2009, I was in HMP Wayland, and my oldest daughter. I'd been out of her life for 13 years, lost contact, disengaged, like no contact whatsoever. And while I was in Wayland, I'd received a letter. My daughter had been looking for me. Funny enough, I'd been looking for her as well, but she had been looking for me, obviously found me. On a family visit in HMP Wayland in March 2009. It's been a bit rocky over that time since, but I have such an incredible relationship with my daughter now. I wouldn't change it for the world. She's given me three fantastic granddaughters, two of whom were born when I was in jail. The third one wasn't, so there's another notch on the thing, if you like. tick off the list. My two sons as well. I've got a fantastic relationship with them. We're not in each other's pockets. I don't have that much to do with my own family. My mum and dad died. My mum died, as I say, when I was 21. My dad died 5 years later. That kind of, the family drifted apart after that. But I don't want to, anyway, that's another story. but I don't have that much to do with my own family. It's a shame. I haven't been barred from the family or anything. I just haven't re-engaged with them after turning my life around as such. I kind of, that was my old life. Even brothers and sisters, that was my old life. Do you know what I mean? And I'm completely different from, I do feel like an only child, without sounding horrible, but that's all selfish. That's me being selfish. And I don't care that I'm being selfish, because I'm being selfish for the right reasons this time.
You've been through so much, you've been through such a time, how else are you supposed to manage things? You just try and do the
if
best
you want to turn your life around, especially in prison, if you want to turn, you have to be selfish. You can't. So I didn't do it. I'm going to sound thing here, but I didn't do it for anybody. I turned my life around for me. And I do what I do now, number one, for me, because I also think that rehabilitation is an attitude, and it allows me to keep that attitude of being rehabilitated. You don't stop becoming a criminal as such, if you like. It's like, even now, I can see, do you know what? I see crime all around. You know what I mean? I see the opportunities. I don't not see those things anymore. It doesn't, oh, I've turned my life around, that's it, I've stopped seeing things. I see loads of criminal opportunities. Difference is, I choose not to do them. I don't need to do them, because for me, committing crime was never about the money. It was all about the adrenaline rush, the camaraderie between people. That was the reasons for committing crime, becoming part of, again, it might be irrational, but becoming part of a family where everyone was the same. I was nowhere near the same as my brothers and sisters, my mum and dad, but the people that I hung around with, we were all the same. So I'm in a relationship now that I've been in a relationship for, what, coming on to 4 years?
Nice one.
Four and a half years, sorry. Four and a half years. I don't want to be disparaging to anybody else that kind of I've been in, but I've never been happier in a relationship than I have now. But then I've never been me, who I am now. Do you know what I mean? I've had relationships in the past where I've been happy. Parts of that relationship I've been happy. But that wasn't me. Do you know what I mean? That was somebody else back then.
Well, maybe this is the real you that we're actually seeing after all these years now, finally emerging.
It's the person I've evolved into because of what had gone on in my life previously.
I see.
Although I say I'm selfish because of what I do, what I do because of me, I do it as well because of obviously what comes of it.
Absolutely.
I do a lot of work with the Ministry of Justice, do a lot of work probation, HMPPS, NHS, Health and Justice as well. And again, it's all about utilizing all of that experience in making them aware. I mean, it's not even about making changes. It's about making them aware so that when they do, because even people that I speak to now that are, if you like, that are in lower jobs, they're younger than me. They're going to be in management one day. They're going to be directors. They're going to be CEOs. So when they're in those positions, I want them to be aware of the decisions and the impact that they make. So again, it's not about influencing them to make decisions right now. It's all about that long term. It's about one of my favorite things that I do. I don't publicize it, but one of my favorite things that I do is talk to students that are doing their dissertation on something relevant and they want to speak to someone with lived experience. And I love doing that because these people are going to be our new solicitors, our barristers, our probation officers, our judges, our magistrates, our police officers. You know what I mean? But I've said probation. So again, it's about early intervention. The more that people understand before they get into the job, the less likely they're going to be impacted by the culture of the environment because they're going to understand all of it. Do you know what I mean? They're not going to be, oh, well, this is the way we do it around here. So, well, you're doing it wrong. Because it's not having an impact. It's not having an effect. This is what we need to do to be having an effect, to have an impact.
Absolutely. You mentioned just a bit earlier that there's another organisation that you wanted to touch on about the work that they do and the work that you
Revolving
do.
Doors.
Yes.
Do you know what? Revolving Doors. I absolutely love Revolving Doors. Get paid for the time that I do there. They were created in the 90s, and basically they were looking at the drivers behind crime, why people were trapped in the revolving doors of crisis and crime. It's not because they're bad, it's because of all these things. And back then we were ignored, we were forgotten people, we didn't have a voice. And Revolving Doors, through research and involvement of lived experience, started giving us a voice. And I think it was 2008 that Revolving Doors set up their own lived experience team, National Forum. And then from that, they've just grown into what they are today. And they're an incredible charity that we have forums. We have a women's forum. We have a new diversity forum. We have a lived experience team that are solely linked to the work of the NHS Health and Justice non-custodial team. Where I represent the views of the lived experience team. So we have the lived experience team, we work alongside the NHS, and then two of us then go on to the board level and we represent the views of the and the opinions of the lived experience team at the board level in NHS. I'm involved in Reconnect and something called Enhance Reconnect. Other people have been involved in mental health treatment requirements. They've been involved in community service treatment requirements, so the MHTRs. The inclusive workforce program. So that's basically the NHS England Health and Justice improving their recruitment policies and practices so that they can start employing more and more people that have got lived experience with the criminal justice system.
Well, Revolving Doors are really doing great work.
They're opening doors. That's what I call them, opening doors, because, again, it's not just the stuff that I do through them, but because of what I do through them, obviously people get to hear my voice. They get to know who I am. So then I get invited to other things and I get asked to do other things. So, Revolving Doors. I mean, just, and it's not just the work that we do. It's the way that they look after the team, their members. And their staff. I mean, they really do support us. And it's not just about that either. It's how they empower us. It's not about us making Revolving Doors look good. It's about Revolving Doors giving us a platform so we can look good.
Got it. And just thinking, is there anything else that we should cover? Because, you know, this has been, you know, a great...
I was going to say, how long you got all week. I mean, we could talk about, but bringing it back again to basic terms, Oliver, it really is about understanding that people aren't born bad. Mm-hmm. And that the more time, money, support, whatever that we put into our children, the less our prisons will be full and the more prisons that we will start to close. Back in 2012, the University of Edinburgh done some research into why their prisons were so full. And they concluded that the way to deal with the overcrowding in Scottish prisons is to stop school exclusions.
Makes a lot of sense, just on the basis of what you said. And I think on that...
It does. I mean, the school to prison pipeline really is, has a massive, major impact on the numbers of people in prison. And therefore, it has a major, massive impact on our communities. It makes them less safe, not more safe. So by excluding children from school, you might be making a school look better on a school league table, but you're making the community a lot less safe.
Absolutely. Very well put. It looks like, you know, we could go on for another couple
we
of
could do
for sure. Yeah. Would you be willing to come back on again in the future, maybe?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't want to go over the same stuff. So once I've got a few things that have, there's a few things that are coming up that might be handy to talk about in the future, that hopefully would have come to fruition. That would be not completely different, but, that give me a different story to tell.
Absolutely. You've got a lot of stories to tell, that's for sure. I've not really come across people with a more eventful life than you, I have to say.
Do you know what? I'll be quick, right? And even though it was a number of years ago, it was the catalyst for me kind of where I am now. And that was in 2005 in HMP Blunderston. I became a mentor for Shannon Trust. Shannon Trust are a charity who train people in prison who can't read to teach people who can't read to read. It sounds so simple, and it is. And it's now called, back then it was called Toe by Toe. Now it's called Turning Pages. And what I started to understand was that, one, how common my story was with everybody else in prison. Two, how tapping into our own lived experience can help not just connect with people, but influence them themselves. I mean, I was brilliant at giving advice in prison. I never took it. That's why I always kept going back. But I was brilliant in thinking. But you get to find out so much more about yourself by giving it to others. So then I become a listener for the Samaritans. Everyone knows who the Samaritans are. I'm basically listeners are doing the work of the Samaritans in prison. And that just really enhanced everything that I kind of learned from being a mentor. And that made me become a better person, but in prison, not out here. I didn't know how to live out here. I knew how to live in prison. I was comfortable. I was safe. I was secure. I had purpose. I had value. I was somebody. But as soon as I walked out of that prison gate, I was nothing. And it was all about starting again. But as soon as I landed back in prison, I didn't have to start again. it was already there. Do you know what I mean? It was the stuff that I needed taken care of was taken care of, as in food and shelter. So Maslow's hierarchy of needs. All of those were kind of fulfilled over the length of my relationship in the criminal justice system. And then obviously it's my self-actualization where I kind of, well, hold on a minute, I've got all of that and I'm not doing anything with it. I do everything in there, but not out here. So as I say, it's I've been doing this type of work in prison for a number of years, trying to use my experience to influence policy and practice change. But it was only later on in life that I realized that I could do that out here rather than keep going back.
Exactly. Yeah. We need you out. We need you out.
Yeah. But there's loads of people like that in prison that are doing these sort of things. They just need that pathway. Absolutely. When they're coming out. Do you know what I mean? And organizations like Revolving Doors, and there are others out there that are doing similar things. And there's also like female women that are also out there doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. Because although it's prison, and obviously there's massive prison estate, I will never know what it's like to be sent to or released from a female prison.
Of course.
And obviously it's like the same thing for females as well. So it's really nice that we have such a mix. And of course you bring in race and religion as well, that mm-hmm. I wouldn't know what it's like to go through prison black or as a Muslim or so on and so forth. So I'm learning off of my peers. Because we're all students and teachers at the end of the day.
Indeed we are. Indeed we are. And on that note, I think that may be a good point to wrap things up. How can people listening and watching follow you and your story? What's the best place to follow you?
LinkedIn. Yeah, LinkedIn, really. Yeah. David Breakspear, yeah. I'm kind of putting all my efforts in. I don't use other social media platforms mm-hmm. other than Instagram, but that's a kind of that's my junk shop, that's my pawn shop. That's just where you'll find like it's miscellaneous on there, whereas obviously with LinkedIn I do try and stick to I say my message, but I haven't really got a message other than change. We want change. It's time for change, and I know we've been saying that for years, but the time's now.
Yeah, absolutely. If listening and watching, follow this man. You know, it's definitely worth your while. Thank you.
Or Omar, and Omar, should I say. Omar's quality. Omar and no doubt the guests you've got coming up in the future as well.
Got some interesting ones lined up for sure. Yeah.
The voice of lived experience is becoming salt now. It was ignored for so many years, but now it's being salt. And there are people that are coming out of prison that are being able to use their lived experience for good and going into work where their lived experience is a plus and not a minus. I mean, it wasn't that long ago where coming out of prison, everything was a minus. You never come out with a plus. But now people are coming straight out of prison into work. It's improving, but we could be so much better. I don't understand why we don't have the best prison system in the world. Why have the worst? It doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. The worst prison system doesn't work.
Yeah. Well, you know, not for long. Yeah, hopefully.
Not for long.
Got any luck? All right. Well, thanks very much for coming on. Really appreciate it, David.
Thank you very much, Oliver.
All right. Take care, mate.
Cheers. See you later. And thanks for listening, everyone.